I was drafted. We could choose the part of army we wanted to serve in. I could go to Norway as an occupation army soldier. I could go to France, to Holland, to Belgium, but I was the only one from 300 who was standing naked in front of the officers. And they asked, and what do you want? I said, I want to go to Russia to keep Stalin where he is. I don't want the Russian hordes to go over Western Europe. And they said, you know what can happen to you if you go to Russia? I said, yeah, I know. All I can do is I could die.
At 80 years of age, Mr. Scheer wrote his sobering story of faith and survival. He joins us today at 95 to share from his experience on the front lines.
I got shot through the leg, and this was that was 1944, in a huge, huge attack from the Russians that came to with us. And that is what is still in my head. And I cannot get it out. Mm-hmm. And even in the night, if I sit on my sofa, I am in the butt, in this bottle. Mm-hmm. And then I say, be quiet, forget about this bottle, but it's not going out of my head.
Yes.
And during this bottle, huge bottle, God proved me that he was always with me.
During the war, Mr. Scheer had a detailed vision that he would be shot in the leg, but would not suffer any harm or permanent damage. It was also revealed how he would miraculously go home for Christmas. Every detail of his vision came to pass.
This man who shot me, if he would have gone a quarter inch higher, he would shot me in the intestines. If he would have put 1 millimeter further left with his gun, he would hit the bone and lose all my blood and I die. It didn't happen. I have my leg. I can still walk. And God had to be with me. That was too dangerous, this whole thing. And when this Russian guy came out and powered through my leg, it made only, like an electric
shock,
little. A Mongolian said, a guy from real Mongolian features. Mm-hmm. He had a machine gun and he said, if you don't kill this guy, he kills us. And I said, you are right. And I wasn't sure what that was. In this moment, that Mongolian guy stopped and said, are you hit? Yeah, kill the Russian with his gun. And he asked me if I am hit. So how come he knew that I was hit? I said, yeah, I felt something like an electric shock here. And I went back to the trenches. The Mongolian was yellow-brown, real guy from the Mongolia, and he had eyes like this. I said, in a German uniform. Well, Hitler was a racist. Mm-hmm. He had no guys like this in a German uniform. So who was it? I never saw a guy with Asian features in the German army. So how can that be?
He was undercover for God.
Then he proved me he can do whatever he wants.
Yes.
He can do everything, absolute everything. Between Warsaw and the German border, the train will stop and the orderly will go out and he will cut a little pine tree and he puts it in an empty tin can and puts some from the railway, then some stones in to make it stand up. and then for you it's Christmas. Now, will you believe I got on this day when the big attack was,
so this
I
was
got
like a vision,
shot
yeah.
exactly through there. And when they put me in the train, and in the train there were more dead people in than alive. And the train started to roll, and after a few hours, the train stopped, the orderly looked out and said, "Oh, you know, you remember that there were on the train, there were signals, you know? So the signal is down." So he went out and cut a little pine tree and put it in a tin can and put stones around. And in that moment, I didn't remember during this bubble what the vision said. But now that he cut down the little tree and put the stones out in an empty tin can, I could really suddenly see the whole vision becomes true, you know? Mm. And who can tell me the exact details of a battle and the outcome? It's only God who can tell me this. Down here was the river, there were about 1,000 men down there. And I said, that's dangerous if they drop bombs, so I walk here. And a shot rang out from the house up there, and the school teacher fell dead. Then I said, it's too dangerous if I walk near these houses. I go down there where the 1,000 men were. I went down, and I walk beside the lieutenant, a young lieutenant, just arm on arm, there were men on men on men. And a shot rang out, and the lieutenant fell dead. It went on, and then I made an attack against the forest. There was a general with 5 officers standing around his 4-wheel drive, you know. And they shot with an anti-tank gun at him, and the whole thing went up. Pow! And we sat down to rest on a big tree. I was left, here was another one, and there was a third one. These two were friends from the same village in Germany. And one had a bottle of water, but the water was not clean, whatever. Wigglers in it, there were insects in it, you know, that was a dirty water, but my mouth was completely dry. I had to drink a little bit. I said, give me a little bit of water, just put my hold on. He said, no, that water is for me and my friend. He didn't give me the water. And in that moment, a grenade went apart up in the trees, in the big branches, and a part of this mantle came. You know, if you rip that apart, the parts of a grenade, they are sharp like razors. It's not just a piece of metal that they are very sharp. And I heard it coming. It hit him right through the breast bones and got stuck in the lung. He was dying. He had maybe 5 minutes left. If the lung is full blood, that's it. You cannot go on. But he was arm on arm with me here. His arm was here, nearer than you. And I was not hit there. Then we went on in a village. And it was a beautiful day in the village. There was wooden sidewalks. I was sitting here on the left. Beside me were 2 guys I knew. A shot rang out from the house, and the man beside me fell in the street.
your stories remind me of Psalm 91. And for people like us who haven't been to war, you know, we read this psalm and a lot of us will look at it as a comparison to the things that happen in our life. But I find Psalm 91 for you was literal. That's such a testimony of God at work and so real in your life.
Yeah.
There was two times that you were suicidal, and the one was when right before you were captured as a prisoner of war, and the second time was when you went back home of all things.
Yeah.
You know, you would think that you would go through a year and a half on the front lines. You were 4.5 years as a prisoner of war in Siberia and everything you went through there, and then you come home thinking, okay, relief, I'm home. But apparently it was everything but that.
No, it was not, no. It was not heaven when I came home.
Right.
My mom was not too bad. My two sisters were very, very happy when I came home. My father was indifferent. And then I had to walk in the forest to get healthy and to fix my brain.
Because you had rags for clothes. You were starved, you were 90 pounds. Yeah. So you were 6 years total.
Yeah. And I came home and I said, where are you coming from?
But how many years after the war did you go back home?
The war ended 1945 in May, and I came home in 1948, the end of November. Then I came home at 2 o'clock in the night, but now I tell you how disappointing it was. I went to bed at 3 o'clock on a small sofa, was maybe 4 feet, I couldn't stretch out. And now my father tells me, on the first hour I wake up, after 3 hours sleep or 4 hours sleep, split the wood behind the house, you know. Because my liver didn't work and my kidney don't work, and because the kidneys didn't work, I had water in my body. And my heart was very irregular. So I had all these sicknesses, so I went to the doctor and said, where is your card from the healthcare? I said, I come from Siberia. I have no card, healthcare card. And they said, we cannot help you. They didn't help me. They didn't examine me. They didn't want to know. They didn't want to see me.
And you went home to a family that was void of love?
Yeah.
Your service for your own country was not even appreciated or acknowledged.
No.
You the other day how, you know, you cope with that. You know, you said you would go to the bush and you would walk all day.
All day, yeah. I was walking in the forest all day. And at this time, I didn't think this way, but later here, after I came to Canada, I thought, if my mom would give me a small thermos bottle with black coffee with me and one sandwich, I could sit down on a fallen tree and at 12 o'clock and eat. Would have been so nice, but she didn't give me nothing on my way. Nothing. And I walked a half a year every day in the forest and came out. There was no love really, nothing. And I was 24 years old. This world is not for me. I did my best during the war and in Siberia, but now I can see there is no place for me anymore, not in this German society. and I decided to hang myself. It was a Friday, and I said, no, tomorrow is Saturday, and Saturday and Sunday it's a little bit better at home. My sisters are at home, so I have somebody to talk. And so, but on Monday I will do it. But then I thought, I haven't got money for a rope. I didn't have the money for the rope. In this moment I saw a face on my right side and he said, did you forget him? You know, I decided to hang myself. Now this face said, did you forget him? And I turned around and I saw a whole crucifix behind me. And I said, no, 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 no. I didn't forget him. So I went home. And asked my sister if she has a piece of paper and a pencil. I want to draw. I was good in drawing all my life. I will draw this, what I saw there. And I drew it. Mother found a job for me and...
But that was you said you promised God you would never think of suicide again at that moment.
Yeah. I cannot do it because God didn't want me to do it. He helped me so much,
right.
Not for me now to commit suicide, you know.
Right.
So I knew he didn't want that. And then God told me when I came back from Siberia, he told me in Poland, now you go home for a few years and then you go on to Canada. Canada, I don't know Canada, what is there? Is there a cow that I could milk? Is there maybe an apple tree or what is there? And he didn't answer me. My wife really appreciated the love and the friendliness of the people here in this land. And me too. I like the people here and I like this land.
Well, we're sure glad you came.
Yeah, I was very happy that I could come.
And I'd like to hear about your story when you were 3.5 years old.
Yeah, when I was 3.5 years old, my sister was 6.5. And she went to a convent school, and when she came home, I had nobody to play. I said, what did you learn? Did you learn how to write? No. So what did you learn? She said, we learned all about the life of Jesus. And she told me a lot of things of Jesus, also that he was nailed to a cross, but I didn't understand why, you know. And then I couldn't digest this. So much cruelty here on earth. And I decided next day to go to the church. And I said, I heard what happened to you. How could they do that? How could they do? And you healed so many people and you did so many good things and they nailed you to a cross. I said, look, I wanted to tell you, if the whole world is against you, I am for you, and I will love you forever. And then I said to him, I wanted to bring you some flowers, but I haven't got any money. So I said, what can I give my mom if she goes for a visit? She always brings something. And now I haven't got anything for you. And then I thought, what is it, what could I give him? And my friendship for life. And I said, I give you my friendship for life. And I walked out, but I didn't know. My wanting to be his friend, that was certain. But I was not sure if he gives me his friendship. But then on the front line, he gave me that vision, and he showed me that he was always my friend, you know. Because I prayed before that big battle, I was sitting on a fallen tree, and I said, tomorrow they will attack, and if I die, and why should I die here in the snow, hungry, homesick? Why, what did I do wrong? I never walked with a girl on my hand over any street of this world, and now I should die? I cannot understand that, you know. But even if I die, I still love you. I absolutely always love you, even if I die tomorrow here. And the next day, the big battle started, and lot of people died on our side and this side. And I was alive, and I had the shot through the leg, and I went home for Christmas. And I never forget that prayer, you know. It's because I didn't know, are you really my friend tomorrow, you know? And how can you stop a bullet? If the Russian aims at my head and pulls the trigger, I'm dead. And now I said, I'm sorry, I found the limits of your power, you know. I really thought I find the limits of his power. He cannot stop that bullet. But next day he proved me, no bullet hit me, and it made, you know, when they go over you, they make each bullet, and there were bullets, thousands of bullets, and I didn't get a bullet. And he proved me, look, you don't have to worry about me. I have the power to stop bullets. Yes. That's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. But you know, many things with God we cannot fathom, you know. Yes. We cannot find out about it. Like my shot through the leg. He let me survive in the river. He let me survive when my sergeant killed himself. He survived when my foot was stuck in the roots. I survived when the channel was blown up. I survived when I was on the tree down there with the two guys when the splinter. And a piece of the bomb hit.
Well, you were saying how, you know, you gave God your friendship and you were wondering why did he die, and that's exactly why he died. You know, so that it's not about a religion, it's not about the do's and the don'ts, it's about having that relationship with him. That's why he died, that we could have direct access to God and feel his presence and know his love, you know?
Yeah, absolute.
Yeah.
And then I saw that my vision became true. It's hard to describe, you know, hard to put it in words, you know, what I felt, you know, at this moment.
We can just learn so much from your story. And there's a lot of people from the Jews or Europeans or North Americans, but we don't often get to hear from a German, you know, and it's kind of ironic. You think that the most important thing is love. We're always so quick to label the enemy as this or that, and you didn't want to go, but you had no choice. And that's one of the things I appreciate about you is the life that you have, and you're 95 still wanting to inspire people. And that just goes to say, even when you're retired, you're not done.
No, you should not cry.
It's good cries. It's good tears. It's good tears.
Yeah, it's a good tears. I know that. I cry sometimes too. But then I get up and do something. Sometimes I put the TV on to forget Sometimes because it's hard to forget all that, you know. It's very hard to forget.
The depression Mrs. Scheer struggled with for most of her life took a toll on their marriage. Even though his friends would sometimes encourage him to leave her, his response reveals the heart that abides within this man.
Your friends were saying, just leave your wife. You know, you could have such a happy life without her, just move on and leave her. But she was sick and she was depressed. And you said you had one voice on this side saying, yeah, maybe I should. And then you had one voice on this side saying, no. And what you said was, I can't leave her because she's the one that suffers most.
Yeah.
Even more than me.
Yeah.
You know,
no, I would never leave her. We all have troubles. Mm-hmm. We all are troubling. We have, one is hungry, one is alone, mm-hmm. one is crippled, one cannot see anymore, the next one loses his partner, the next one misses his child who is mm-hmm. living on the other end of the land. What we should do is have moments of joy in our lives too, you know, and if it's only minutes, we have to get up and get going, because not all people live like we live. We go to a supermarket, there's everything to eat. It's not everywhere. You know, somebody I know, they invited people from Russia to come here to visit. They came to a supermarket and they all started to cry. They started to cry because they had nothing at home. They had hardly anything to eat.
But what would you say to people that are going through tough times? Like, obviously, you had a very difficult life, but look at you now, or to know that there's always hope, and there's always hope for good to come out of our lives if we don't give up, if we don't give up on God, and we don't give up on ourselves. And
you are the light. Even in this darkness, you mm-hmm. are the light. We have to, even if the sky is dark as it is today, we have the light in us. Mm-hmm. We go on and we live and we know that we have a future. Mm-hmm. And we should not despair and walk our path, which Jesus gave us by mm-hmm. dying on the cross. He made it possible for us to go to God, and he opened up a path to, mm-hmm. for us to go. But it's very important, where are we going? That is the important question. Mm-hmm. And if we know Jesus Christ, we know where we are going, because he said on the last day, and in the last verses of Matthew, Jesus said, I'm going now and I prepare a place for you. And if he prepares a place, he, Jesus, with all his love and his power, that is a fantastic place. So when we are there, and you know, the most important word on this earth should be love, but it isn't. But in heaven, love is the biggest word. I'm very happy, and that is only because I had a friendship with God. Mm-hmm. I had this friendship with God. That's why he pushed me from here and here and here and here. And on the end, it was all good, because I know where I'm going, and I know that every word he said to us while he was on earth becomes true. Every word becomes true, absolutely.